So, good evening, everyone. Once again, my name is Mrunal. I am the founder at Sunday Bricks. I am a certified Six Bricks trainer. Six Bricks is a program that was developed by Care for Education in South Africa. And of course, now it's supported by the LEGO Foundation. Great. So, what do I do at Sunday Bricks? Why is this session all about play? So, well, at Sunday Bricks, I design creative workshops using bricks and blocks. Of course, you can see multiple types of blocks here. So I design theme-based workshops, and probably that's the best way I feel we can engage children. Now, a lot of times parents or teachers, they ask me that, why did you start Sunday Brick? What's the story behind Sunday Bricks? So, I'm just going to make it really short and simple. Apparently, I have a good collection of Lego and or bricks and blocks. And apparently I wanted my son to get engaged with them. Now he was just not ready to play with them. So that's when it struck to me that, I have to do something about it. There has to be some way by which a child is going to be able to enjoy bricks and blocks, because I haven't come across anyone who doesn't play with blocks. Of course, you need to find ways and means by which they can play. And that's exactly what gave birth to Sunday Bricks. Well, I'm just going to keep Sunday Bricks aside, but I'm going to talk about all these little things here, which of course we call them commonly, which is commonly known as blocks. But before that, the most important question, and also before the question, I'm going to divide this little the seminar or this little talk in two parts. One, I'm going to emphasize and talk about play, and the second part is where I'm going to kind of demonstrate some activities, some techniques, and we'll talk about how we can engage our children with blocks. Great. So my first question to all teachers, all caregivers, and all parents out there: what do you mean by play? What is, according to you, as a teacher, as a parent, as a caregiver, what according to you is the definition of play? What do you think is play, right? So you can of course quickly type in the chat box or in the comment section what according to you is play. I'm just going to wait for like 10 seconds, and I know there's a bit of lag, but we'll have comments coming in. We'll have comments coming in very shortly. Great. So play is something that is fundamental. It is a fundamental activity for a child, and of course the child becomes an adult. So it's one of those activities that we are born and we need to do, and we engage, or we kind of get involved in it, involuntarily, right? And the definition of play also says that it's actually the work of the child. What work does a child have to do? Nothing, just play as much as he or she can. Now, and play is also in our nature. Nobody would teach us how to play. Probably they could just teach us how to, I mean, we could learn some skills, we could rule use we could learn some rules, but how to play, what is play? No, we don't need to be told about that, right? And did you know that, for younger children, play is a means by which they can communicate to adults? Yes, they can express their wishes, they can express their wants, they can express their needs, their feelings, everything, through the form of play. Now, the other day I remember, of course, going to parks is not allowed, but we still go down in the building sometime. Due to the lockdown, we're not supposed to go out. And my son wanted to play football, and apparently his friend didn't come. So I was telling him, okay, you and I are going to play. So, of course, he's not in the right mood. He doesn't want to play with me. He wants to play with a friend. So what is he doing? He is kicking the ball very, very slowly. I'm like, come on, let's play. But he's like, this is the way I play football. So now what is he trying to do? He's just trying to express that he's not happy. He was waiting for his friend to come. So kids, actually, in form of play, or while they're playing, they actually tell us a lot of things, right? So play is very, very important. Now, another thing that I read very much, that I felt was quite important and quite real, that if you are with a person for a year, you wouldn't know that person as much as you would know that person in 1 hour of playtime, right? You play with somebody, you know, you have a games night with family and friends, and you play with the person for 1 hour, and you really know what this person is up to. You really know the skills of this person, the behavior, and a lot more traits about a person can be known in 1 hour's play. Absolutely. So this is, you know, that's why play is very, very important. And of course, play is must. And there's a lot of research happening around play. Of course, I'm not going to get into all of that. But before I get onto the blocks, let me just talk a bit more. Okay, I just have a message here. Okay. Okay, great. Yeah, thank you. So the next thing would be that, you know, what are the different types of play forms? So one could be the physical form, wherein, you know, you're just going, playing in the garden, you're running around, you're climbing on the ladder, and you're going down the slide, and all of that is a physical form of play. Then you've got the pretend play, you know, when kids are visiting Kidzania, or, you know, they pretend to be a doctor, they pretend to be a fireman. So that's the pretend play of form. And then you've also got, you know, wherein you play with objects. So for example, you know, younger children, they love to play with a plate, they love to play with a spoon, and they're just banging the plate and the spoon. That's just playing around with any objects that are there around in the house. They could also create some simple music. Also, that is, you know, just playing around with some object. And of course, you know, once the child is older, he or she is going to play with board games. So that's when, you know, those games come in, which have rules and regulations and all of that. Great. Now, parents play a very, very, very important role, you know, not just in deciding what the child is going to play, but in a lot of things, like, for example, in deciding what toys a kid is going to play with, you know, what activities the kid is going to get involved in. Of course, you know, we always consider their interest. We also consider, you know, what they like, you know, what is being offered in school and all of that. But parents do play a role. So it's very important that parents actually get involved in, you know, what they want to offer to their child, because play definitely has a lot of benefits. And I'm just coming to that. Right. Great. Great. Right. So if you can just quickly let me know what, according to you, are the benefits of play. Of course, I'm going to list it down. I'm going to talk about it. But why is it that across the world, you know, the scientists or psychologists, they emphasize that children these days need to play much more? Why is it so? Of course, you know, there's this great debate about the screen time and all of that, but I'm just going to keep that aside. But trust me, as per the norms, a child until the age of 12 is supposed to play for at least 3 hours. So, you know, 3 hours of outdoor play should be what a child should be exposed to during a day. But, you know, when they found out, you know, what's the ground check for it, a child between the age of 10 and 12 is not playing for more than 12 minutes, okay? Average 12 minutes is what the outdoor play is. And of course, kids from the age of 5 until the age of 9, not more than an hour. So, you know, this kind of leaves us to a point wherein we really need to think about it, because it's really, really crucial. And that's why there's so much of research happening around play. But why is it so important? You know, so for that, we need to understand what are the benefits of play, right? Now, so many skills that we need to kind of inculcate in our children. So for example, creative skills, cognitive skills, behavioral skills, emotional skills, social skills, all of that can be achieved, or all of that can be kind of acquired, or all of that can be kind of polished with the help of different play methods. Of course, what else do they learn? They learn about problem solving. Play also reduces their stress. Of course, the most important thing is it helps them develop their motor skills. When I'm, you know, this one, of course, you know, holding it, pressing it here, that's when it's dealing with the fine motor skills. But of course, when they bend, when they crawl, when they go under the table, when they're going through a tunnel, it's helping them with all their gross motor skills. Of course, you know, when a child is playing for an hour, playing with friends and family and cousin, you know, the spirit is absolutely different. I mean, the happiness on the child's face is amazing because they've forgotten all that they have to do at home. I mean, younger ones don't even have stress, but you know, a child who is in grade 3, grade 4, who still has homework and all of that to do, when they are in the park or when they are in the playground, they've just forgotten everything. So the level of stress is always down. They're always calm and they're always happy, happy. It helps them control their emotions. It regulates their emotions. All of that they learn with the help of play. Great. And of course, you know, when children have some developmental issues, you know, play therapy is something that is always recommended because that can help in dealing with aggression, that can help in dealing with low self-esteem, you know, helping in building up speech or the vocabulary, can, you know, kind of reduce the depression. If the child is under some depression, that can all be taken care with the help of play therapy or, you know, play. Right. So that was all about play. I'm not getting much into the theory part of it because, you know, that can always be taken care later. But the most important part about today's seminar or about today's talk is all about how am I going to engage my child with bricks and blocks? Absolutely. So first, before that, you know, I'm just going to quickly check what questions have been coming in. Okay. Absolutely. Yes. Okay, so there are some questions, which I'm going to kind of take all of that at the end. So, you know, we don't break the link, but I'm just going to keep a tab on my phone because that's how First Cry team is in touch with me. Great. So first, you need to understand what are the types of blocks available around you, right? So there's this kind of block that you kind of see in the market. Of course, it's by a company called Mega Blocks. And this is great for children, you know, who kind of can hold objects very easily. You know, they have started developing a grip. And of course, they kind of have realized that, you know, I don't have to chew this or I don't have to swallow this. So of course, Mega Blocks is something that you can start at the age of 1.5, which is like 18 months, and up to the age of 2 or 3. And then you can move to the next set of blocks that is, you know, which are a little smaller than this one. You know, what I'm holding right now is called Lego Duplo. This is also fairly amazing product, and of course which is quite commonly used in schools or in play schools that we have. And of course, once the child is 5 and above, you know, he or she can engage with the tiny bricks. I mean, they're not called blocks, but of course these are called as bricks. So a lot of structures can, I mean, what you see older children building with is normally this size of bricks, so which is good at the age of, I mean, from the age of 5 and above, right? Absolutely. Now, you know, so there's a very, very, the most common question that I have coming in from parents is that the only thing that my child is building, you know, when I'm talking about a child right now, I'm talking about toddlers until the age of 5. And the common discussion with the parents is that my child is only building towers. What can I do? So absolutely, I mean, discussion that I'm going to have here is that there is a lot more things that can be done just apart from building towers. So there's lots more happening apart from just building towers. You can engage your child in multiple things apart from just building, you know, buildings or something that is just like a small stacking activity. But so if you want to engage your child in something that is more goal oriented or something that has an agenda or, you know, there is some fun into it, we kind of have to set some ground for it. You know, I mean, of course, as parents, as teachers, also, we need to kind of know first that how are we going to make sure that we engage our children using bricks and blocks. Now, remember, if you give a theme, if you give you know, like a specific thing or like a specific topic to your child, trust me, they're going to build something better. So let's just take an example, okay? Let's just take an example about what agenda am I going to set for it. So I'm just going to clear up this table now, okay? Just let these people go away, and I'm going to just kind of start demonstrating a bit. Right, okay, that's my little table here. That's fine. Okay, great. So the first thing is that, of course, we know that children know how to build a tower, but let's just look at a different angle, okay? Let's just look at a different way of building a tower. And you know, because this is going to be very, very challenging. And then, of course, I'm going to come back to why do we need to use blocks and the benefits of blocks and all of that, right? So my first challenge for the child is going to be that, come on, let's build a tower, but what are we going to do? This time, you know, that's the short end and that's the long end. What are we going to do? We are going to stack up short end to short end, okay? Now let's see. How tall a tower you are going to build? Okay. I'm just going to focus. Okay, I'm going to stay calm. Woo! Okay. Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. Absolutely. Right. So there's a lot of fun happening when we're doing this. A lot of hand and eye coordination that's happening. Okay. Now I've got an AC vent here. So I hope that's not the thing that's troubling me. Yes. But my six blocks are here. They're all in a tower here. And they're pretty happy. And they're pretty happy. They're pretty stable. Now, I can go up. I can keep building. Of course, it's not going to fit in a screen. But I remember I was in a workshop. Of course, that was for the teachers. And we eventually managed to build a tower with 32 blocks. Yes, so that was I think a good record, right? Yeah, I hope that's not a wrong figure. Great. So now what's so interesting about it? Now, one, when I am playing with this activity, I mean, I did it really quickly because I've been used to doing this. But when you ask a child to do it, okay, I'm just going to put this down. When you ask a child to do it, one, the child needs to understand how to balance it, you know. So he's going to try and, you know, probably the tower might just wobble off. So there are ways and means by putting it. He or she might put it up like this or like this. And then as it goes up, it might just fall off. So what's happening? They're going to try different methods and then understand that, oh, this is not the right way. You know, let me look for another solution. Let's find another way. How am I going to solve this problem? And then eventually they're going to start having fun. They'll build a taller tower. And then it's going to be like a competition between the children in the classroom or probably, you know, at home between the siblings, who is going to build the tallest tower. Now, you know, once the tower is ready, you know, if we've got to add another fun element to it is who's going to blow the hardest to make sure that the tower falls off. So the child is going to take a deep breath. And then he's just going to blow off, and the tower is going to fall, and the amount of noise that's going to happen in the room, that's going to be a lot of fun, and that's going to be a lot of chaos, which of course the child is going to love it. Now, with just some simple six blocks, of course, you know, we've added so much fun and excitement already. Now, if you've got older kids, come on, you're going to tell me that this was very, very simple, and you know, let's just make it a little more complex. So, what are we going to do? Okay, what am I going to give the child? I'm going to give the child, you know, a pair of pegs. Or, you know, this is what we normally use to hang our clothes. And I'm going to tell the child, okay, let's just stack up the tower. But this time, it's not your hands, but it's going to be this peg that's going to do all the work for you. So, okay, here I picked it up and I'm going to be very, very patient. Okay, so what's happening? A lot of my problem-solving skills, one, my fine motor skills, you know, a test of my fine motor skills because it's not easy for a child to pick this and do it. Second, you know, problem solving, as in, I know that, you know, once I picked it up, once I picked up here, it didn't work fine. So next time I'm going to kind of pick it up, I'm going to pick up the block in another position. So, you know, you are kind of, yes, sorry, right, absolutely. So you're kind of solving a problem there for yourself, a lot of patience, a lot of concentration, and a lot of focus. So something that's very, very, very simple. Of course, In six breaks, what I've been trained for from South Africa, we've got actually an entire curriculum by which we could engage children throughout the year in multiple activities, right? Now, all these activities that, with just blocks, it's not just about some activity that's just dealing with fine motor skills, but we're dealing with creativity. We're also dealing with math. We're also dealing with languages. We're also dealing, the social aspect, because when two kids are, playing in a team, a lot of social aspect is also involved. And of course, a lot of activities that can be done with this can also be in form of games. Now, I just spoke about language. So how can we improve language skills? Great. So, our agenda as a parent for the day is to kind of make sure that, we're teaching the child things like top and bottom. Okay, these are the two words that I want my child to get used to during this session. So what am I going to say? Okay, ignore the colors for now. So what am I going to say? Okay, let's put the first block. Okay, I'm just going to keep this here. Okay, here's my first block. Okay, now assume this is an orange color. Okay, let me assume this one is the orange color. So that's the orange color. Now take the red brick, take the red block, and put it on top of the orange block, right? And put it on top of the orange block. Now, take another yellow block and put it under the orange block, right? So now what's happening? They're listening. They've started to understand positioning, or the spatial thinking. They know what is on top. They know what is at the bottom. And if I have to take it to the next level, I'm going to probably tell the child that, how about you place a blue brick between the red and the orange brick? Okay, so now that's a lot of instructions, okay? My first instruction was to take the blue brick. Then I am supposed to place it between the red and the orange brick. Now that's quite complicated, and that's quite complex thinking for a child. But of course, that's what we want them to learn, which is something that is very, very easily possible with the help of blocks. And of course, as things can get, we can also complicate things by showing them, to put it in this pattern, or okay, this is another pattern, of course, where I'm using another type of block here. And if you want to make it really complex, that's a three-dimensional setup, which is going to be really challenging for a child, and of course, open up a lot more skills, or open up a lot of thinking dimension for the child. Great. So, this was all about, how do I put in, how do I make sure that some skills are getting into my child, or how do I engage him or her with simple activities. But, bricks and blocks is also all about creativity. I mean, how can I engage my child creatively? So I'm just going to quickly sip in water, and I'm just going to come back with another act, something that we've built. Okay, just going to quickly look at all of this. Great. So let me just show you. Okay, you remember these little people here? Absolutely. What have we got here? We've got a nice storytelling session happening. Okay, who's here? This Mr. Sad is not ready to look at me. Yes. Here we've got Mr. Happy, and here we've got Sad. Now, how have we made this? Just by simply using two blocks. Okay. So they could nicely build puppets using blocks. Okay. It's very, very simple, and they could just add a lot of material that they have. Another nice thing that they could also do is, for example, I've got some 12, 13 pieces here, and my challenge is that with just these many blocks, okay, I'm just going to open it up. Okay, with just these many blocks, the challenge that's given to me is that I need to quickly build a flower. Okay, very, very simple. So how are we going to do that? Now, of course, how to get this skill in children also, that's going to be my next step. Okay, so very simple. I am just going to stack up here. That's my little stem that I'm building. That's my little leaf. Okay. And I'm going to start building the flower. Now, remember, this involves a lot of skills, okay, from a child, because one, I mean, okay, if it's on the mat, it's different. But if I mean, right now I'm holding in my hand because I'm kind of used to this. Okay. Right. Very simple. I've just got a flower ready in just 13 pieces. Here are my flower. I mean, here is a little flower that's ready. Now, you know, when a child is, of course, going to do that in the first attempt, he or she is not going to be able to do that. So they're going to try. They're going to come up with multiple options. And of course, they're going to build. But you need to give them an agenda. You need to give them some motive as to what they're going to build. Now, if we have to kind of let them know that, you know, if they have to build something that's a little complex, if we start reminding them about some shapes and tell them that, you know, this is how we could build, it's going to be easier for them to think. Let me just show you how we could build a fish with the help of three triangles. Okay. Okay. I'm just going to quickly show that to you. Okay. Now, here's my little fish. Okay, I've of course involved an eye because that's the circle shape. But if I just have to build something, you know, which is triangle, you know, so one triangle, two triangle, and three triangle. If I'm able to make that, it's very, very easy for me to build a fish. Let me just quickly show you how is that happening. So for example, okay, I'm using the bricks for this one, okay? So that's my first triangle, okay? That's my second triangle. Okay, so I have my first triangle and the second triangle. And what am I going to do is just going to join them up here. Okay, here's my first triangle. Here's my second triangle. And of course, here is my last triangle. And if I just fix it here, I build a small little fish. Now, if we have to tell them to build structures, if we kind of remind them about some shapes, if we remind them about different, say, if we remind them about a rectangle, square, or triangle, or whatever shapes that they know, trust me, it's going to be very, very easy for them to build. Great. So with that, I'm also coming to something else. Right. Now, here's something that we've built, that I've built with the blocks, and it's very simple. Whoops. Here's a nice little bookshelf that's been made with the blocks. Now, A lot of learning is happening while making this little project. One, all my favorite books need to get into this model that I have built. So what are they going to do? They first need to know what is the dimension of the book. They don't know how to deal with a scale. They don't know how to deal with measurement, all the metrics for measurement. But they will still imagine, they will think, you know, that's where those skills come into place. And they will be able to build something as simple as this. Now, this is what I had built for my son. And apparently he tells me that, okay, these are no more my favorite books. Okay, these are not my favorite books anymore. I've got some other books which are my favorites. I'm like, okay, which is your favorite book for now? And he tells me that I want a bookshelf for this book. Okay. So I tell him that, you know, now here's your bookshelf that's ready. Now you have to tell me that how are you going to think and kind of come up with a solution to make sure that this little book fits into your bookshelf. And of course, with some activity or, you know, I mean, with some steps or with some ideas, we were able to find a solution for that. But trust me, you know, kids really know how to solve their problems. It's just that we need to give them an opportunity. Great. How else can we kind of make use of blocks? Now, a lot of boys love Hot Wheels, okay? So what do they have? They've got these nice Hot Wheels tracks. So if we want to make something really interesting, I have just used my block here. Here's my little track. And I can just probably roll down a marble here, or I can just roll down the car. And it's going to be all perfect. Just another way of making, you know, different tracks or different ways for the car to move around. So absolutely, I would always recommend using, you know, these tracks for the cars along with blocks. It's real, real fun. Another thing, I mean, I'm not sure if a lot of you all know, but there's something like a bug that comes in. You know, if I just switch it on, it starts vibrating. So it's kind of a nice, nice sensory toy. And, you know, I'm just going to build a path with a lot of obstacles, and my obstacles are going to be these blocks. And I'm going to leave this little bug loose. I mean, he's not going to move around here, but you know, you can just see this little bug crawling around. And if the bug is crawling around the house or in the school, and you've got these blocks around, you know, we're kind of just making a little tunnel for the bugs. And trust me, it's so much, so much fun. And that's how they kind of know that how best I can use these blocks. Now, trust me, blocks, you know, is blocks are actually one of those manipulatives that you call, or like a play material that you can actually play with in the entire length, in the entire height, and the entire width. So whatever you want to build, you know, as big as, you know, as long as something, I mean, if you want to make it really tall, all of that is really possible with the help of blocks. Great. What I wanted to show you, storytelling, a lot of storytelling activities. You know, once the story is done, you kind of want to know what your child remembers after the session is done. And you know, for example, one of my favorite stories with children is The Hungry Caterpillar. You know, they love it. Now, at the end of the workshop or at the end of the story, if I tell them that, come on, let's build a caterpillar, and trust me, you're going to see amazing caterpillars come in the room. So, I mean, from the last workshop, I know that's a little caterpillar that I have here. Of course, this was made with bricks, but it's very, very easy to do with the blocks. And of course, you remember the caterpillar has an apple, has an orange, has a plum, and all of that. It's so amazing to kind of combine it with a story and then ask them to build. And they're going to really find a reason to build. Absolutely. And of course, you know, stories which involve animal, so like a giraffe or something that's very, very easy to build in like 10 or 15 steps. Of course, they need some guidance from parents. But trust me, if we just engage them with bricks and blocks, they can spend good 2 hours just playing with it. And of course, a lot of skill development is happening. Great. So I'm going to take in questions now. Great. Okay. I'm just going to quickly look at it, but, I'm just also going to check if I missed talking about something. I'm going to probably do that when I just talk. Great. Okay. So, one of the questions I saw is that, how do you deal if your child wants to spend an entire day with Lego? Okay, yes. I mean, of course, as parents, of course, we really know how to set limits. And you really know your child best. But trust me, if it's holiday time, if it's vacation time, if it's Sunday, and if they want to just enjoy with bricks and blocks, I mean, why not? I mean, on one side, parents are talking about, you know, screen time, extended screen time. But here you have a child who doesn't want to kind of get hooked onto screen, but wants to build creatively. Why not? I mean, allow them to play as much as they can. Yeah, I mean, of course, I don't know what's the age of the child, but yes, it's really amazing to have them build that. Right. Are Legos recommended for 8 years old? Yes. When you buy a Lego Classic box, of course, you get a brick like this. And it says the age is 4 to 99, which means that from the age of 4 until the age of 99, you can absolutely engage or happily play with these bricks. So for an 8-year-old, absolutely, I would really recommend that, right? What's coming next? Okay, how can it be used in different ways so the child does not get bored? Yes, Falguni Dave, that was a comment from you. I just demonstrated several things here. I also remember one workshop very, very clearly, wherein, you know, I was kind of dealing with Mr. Men series, and the workshop was all about building Mr. Men characters, and we were building Mr. Tickle. Now, you know, at the end of the workshop, there was so much chaos. There was so much of excitement. Why? Because what Mr. Tickle is all about, right? I mean, he's got very long hands and he can go and tickle around anybody that's there, even at a distance of, say, 500 meters, or, I mean, I don't know about the length, but yeah, as far as anybody can be, you know, Mr. Tickle can go and tickle that person. So everybody in that workshop, kind of wanted to make the longest hand for Mr. Tickle. So there were hands which had 30 breaks, 40 breaks, 50 breaks. So what were they doing? They were actually, they had actually put each of their models next to each other, and they were actually kind of trying to measure and understand who's Mr. Tickle, or which Mr. Tickle had the longest arm. So we're dealing with length, we're dealing with measurement, and so many aspects of mathematics, wherein the child just probably doesn't know that he's dealing with mathematics, and they're just having fun and simple fun, right? So I hope I was able to answer that. Okay, there's a question that my baby is ages 3 years and 9 months. When can you play with blocks? Oh, of course. I mean, you have to really start with blocks. You don't have to wait at all, because as I just mentioned, these blocks, you can start at the age of 1.5. The bigger one, I mean, the other ones can go, I mean, at least up till the age of 5, even more than that. But of course, after the age of 5, they can always engage with the smaller bricks. So 3.5, yes, absolutely. I mean, you can start with blocks immediately. I just answered, when can I start with the blocks? My 2-year-old child just refuses to sit. I hope this question is correct. My child just, okay, from what I understand the question, it says that my child just doesn't play with the blocks. And that's where the whole thing about agenda comes in. I mean, they need to have that fun element. They need to know the purpose of why are they doing this. I mean, how is it that this toy, or how is it that this these blocks that I have is going to add excitement or fun in what I'm building? So for example, let me just show you another small activity that we could do. Now I have a dice here, and I have kept all my bricks here open. And okay, that's our base dice. I'm just going to keep it here. I'm going to roll the dice, and the dice says 2. Now I'm supposed to pick up another brick, and this little thing that I see here, I am just supposed to cover 2 studs. So because on the dice I could just find 2, I can cover up anywhere with just 2. Now I roll the dice once again, and I get, okay, I don't get 5, is not possible, but I get 4. So what am I supposed to do? I'm going to pick up the topmost brick, and I am supposed to cover 4 of these studs. Okay, so I'm just going to show that to you. So the first one was 2, and then it was 4. Now, as you go higher and higher, I mean, this is supposed to be on the floor, but as you go higher and higher, the tower or the little thing that's been built is going to start falling apart. So that's where the trick comes in, that how you are going to place your bricks. So a lot of concepts of physics, a lot of things about gravitational force. Of course, we don't teach them all of that, but those concepts kind of subconsciously get into their mind, right? So we just have to make it interesting. We just have to make it engaging. For example, boys, they have these Hot Wheels cars. They just love it. You ask them to build a garage with the blocks, and trust me, they'll be able to build something very, very happily. Or if they have these superheroes, a hiding place for the superheroes, and they'll build amazing structures with that, right? Somebody just mentioned that, okay, can you show me the caterpillar? Okay, here I'm going to show you the caterpillar. Here's my little caterpillar, and of course you can build it with the blocks as well. Okay, apart from blocks, what other play activities can I adopt for my 4-year-old? Of course, there are a lot of activities, but I kind of believe that everything that's available around, so for example, Play-Doh, or you've got clay, you've got a lot of these other sensory materials, you can actually combine them with blocks, and it's very easy to play. I would always recommend you to mix, different toys. It's always fun because they kind of get bored, and they kind of want excitement. They want something new happening. Apart from blocks. Okay. And, there's somebody asking me how to enroll for a regular class. Right. I mean, of course, you can always check what we're doing on Sunday breaks. And apparently, we should be doing something soon on First Cry as well. So just keep your eye on First Cry for all of that. Great. And I don't see any other question coming in. Okay, great. So, of course, I mean, do post in your questions. And of course, I'm going to be able to, I will answer them as soon as I can. And of course, do make sure that you engage your children with bricks and blocks. I'm just going to wait for another 30 seconds. I'm just waiting for a message from the First Cry team. And I'm just going to end this session. Absolutely. So, okay, what is Six Bricks? Yes. So Six Bricks is basically, okay, I'm just going to quickly show you. 1 second. Right. So Six Bricks is basically a program that was developed by Care for Education in South Africa, you know, wherein by just using six blocks, you know, there's like an entire curriculum that is designed, you know, for parents at home and for teachers at school, by which we can actively engage children with some hands-on activities and some fun and excitement and play and, of course, a lot of learning. Right. Okay, great, wonderful. Okay, so of course I will be able to answer all these questions if they come later on in the comment section. Great. So thank you very much. I hope you had fun and I hope you found another reason or another you know, way by which you can engage your children with bricks and blocks. Great. So here's a big bye, or here's a big shout out from my little team here who's helping me for this workshop. I've got a little birdie here as well. Great. So thank you very much, and make sure that your children are engaged. They're having fun. And of course, you know, I hope this lockdown dies out soon. Great. Thank you very much. Bye-bye, and have a great evening ahead. Right.